because he's only sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, we can't then try to make Christ come for everyone else. Because if you go back to the Old Testament, the Most High says, I change not. If the Most High says salvation is only for Israel, and now you're saying in the New Testament that Jesus come, and now salvation is open to everyone who follows after Jesus, that means the Most High changed. If Christ was on this earth and said, I only came for Israel, and he dies, and now you're saying that that's not true, he came for everyone, you would have to show us where Christ told the apostles that after I die, salvation is open for everyone. I challenge you to find that in the Bible, and you won't. It's simple. When we said at the beginning, Christ had to come for the nation of Israel so they could be delivered, redeemed, saved from the curses of the covenant for breaking him. That's what the salvation is for, to be saved from. But John 3:16 said, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. That is perhaps the most abused text. Because what does verse 14 say? He was telling Nicodemus that in John 3 and 1, was a conversation between two Jews, Nicodemus, a high-ranking Pharisee, and Christ. And they're discussing the state of Israel and who the Messiah is and what needs to happen for Israel. So when you get down to verse 14, Christ explains to him, because Nicodemus is a Jew, he knows the story. He said, just as Moses had to lift up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be delivered up. In that same way Moses had to put that serpent to save Israel, I'm that serpent that has to be lifted up to save them. For God so loved the world. Well, who's the world? Now you got to study the Greek, because in Greek there's three definitions for world. So you got to see what definition applies in what context. In John 3:16, that world right there is cosmos, which just means apt, harmonious arrangement, government, order. Nothing to do with the inhabited earth. Then you have oikomenos, which means the inhabited earth, the all the people. Then you have ion. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, apt, harmonious, orderly government. Has nothing to do with the inhabitants of the world. Well, us Israelites, that's what we believe. So how do we prove it? We take it Isaiah 45, chapter 45, verse 17. But Israel shall be saved with an everlasting salvation, and you shall not be ashamed nor confounded, world without end. He called Israel the world. Look when Christ got ready to leave. I think it's in the book of Acts. He just dropped a bomb on the Pharisees, and he dropped the mic and walked off, and the Pharisees say, look, the whole world has gone after him. He was only in Israel. Christ never left Israel. Read on in the book of Acts, when it says the king of Assyria, or the Roman Caesar Augustus, the Roman emperor, said, let the whole world be taxed. That world is Israel. That's why he kept telling you, if you go and study the history of the Roman Empire in Jerusalem, he said, let the world be taxed, because that's what Israelites referred to themselves as, the world. Because the Roman citizens did not get taxed. Look at Hebrews chapter 1, 1 and 2. God is sundry time. Get to verse 2. Before he created the worlds, plural. It's like if you go to SeaWorld. You're expecting to see all the creatures in the sea. You're not expecting to see tigers, lions, and bears. They don't apply to that world. If I say Michael Jackson's the baddest entertainer in the world, that has nothing to do with NFL. World has context. You got to know. This is an Israelite book talking about Israelite affairs and how they needed help. That's the whole point of the Bible. So those are just a few quick things that I wanted to go over on what us Israelites believe and why we believe as such. The scriptures tell us that when Christ restores the order, the remnants of all the other nations and a remnant of Israel that is spared from death and destruction, the Most High would put all those nations to serve Israel for their punishment for 1,000 years for what they have done to them by putting them in slavery. See, what we cannot do is make the prophecies not come true. Christ said all prophecies must be filled or fulfilled. You got to go into Isaiah chapter 14, which is Israel's recompense, where it says all nations are going into slavery to them. Ezekiel chapter 36. Ezekiel chapter 30. See, that has to happen. That, how can you be a non-Israelite and be saved when the Bible says all Gentiles? Matter of fact, in Ezekiel says that the Israelite, the seed of Israel, would inherit the Gentiles as a possession. So you cannot be a Gentile and think you're going to get equal salvation with Israel. That's what the Bible says. That's not what we think. That's what it says. So before you tell the Israelites, oh, y'all are teaching false doctrines, you got to reconcile those scriptures and don't run from them. All the prophecies must come true, or you got to throw the whole book into the garbage. Because that means a prophecy didn't come true, so what else is not true? Get to Revelations. What did Christ say? I know thy works and thy tribulations, but thou art rich. For I know the blasphemy of them that say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogues of Satan. When Christ says, he that have an ear, let him hear. He that leadeth in captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword, for he is the patience of the saints. Christ just told the other nations, if you got an ear, listen up. If you put my people Israel into captivity, you're going into captivity. He that killed them with the sword is going to be killed with the sword. See, we don't make the Bible say what we want it to say. We live by what it actually says. We don't read into it. We don't add to it. We don't take away from it. So that's why we say salvation is only of Israel. So now the last closing point was, what is the biggest difference between us and Christianity? Biggest difference is because we keep the laws of Moses. Because in not keeping them is what got us in the captivity. But a lot of people have taught, well, Christ did away, you know, with the laws on the cross. Now you got to go to Matthew 5, 17 through 20. Christ says, think not that I come to destroy the law or the prophets. I didn't come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, to heaven and earth pass, not one jot or one tittle shall in any wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. All the prophecies haven't been fulfilled. They all become fulfilled when Christ reigns on earth. So Christ just tell you, if you read in Mark that same passage, it's, Christ says it's easier for heaven and earth to pass than for one part of the law go away. Now, if you're not an Israelite, you don't have to keep the law because the law wasn't given to you. This is strictly talk. He's talking to the Pharisees in Matthew 5. The law has never gone away with. The problem is, y'all been taught that different than us. Y'all have been taught that he died for the law. He nailed your sins to the cross. Remember we read in 1 John that sin is the transgression of the Mosaic law? If you wasn't given a Mosaic law, how can you trespass that sin? How? Sin is the Bible says sin is the transgression of the law of Moses. So if you're not an Israelite, why would Christ need to save you from breaking that law which you were never given? I.e. Brittany Griner. You go to Russia, they have their own laws. You broke their law. So now you're subject to their law. The Most High gave this to Israel and Israel alone. How do we know? Psalms 147:19. He showed his statutes and his commandments, his word unto Jacob and Israel. He had not dealt so with any other nation. As far as the judgment, they do not know them. What did he say he was? Amos 3:2. You only have I known, Israel, of all the families of the earth. Therefore, I will judge you for your sins. Joel 2:27. Israel, I'm in the midst of Israel. I'm your God and none else. The God Yahweh of the Holy Bible, if you type in Jehovah Yahweh, is going to tell you the God of the Israelites. He is our God. The other nations have their gods. Remember, Deuteronomy 4:19, Daniel chapter 7, Deuteronomy 32:7-9 will all tell you this. All throughout the Bible, it tells you there's many gods. So those are just a few things. If you're ever interested in knowing if you're a so-called Black Hispanic or Native American from Negroid descent, and you want to find out if you, in fact, could be an Israelite, sit down with one of them. I know this is information overload, but this had to be done because we have to defend the truth. As the Lord said, who would defend my name? We're not afraid to die for this word. We're not afraid to be persecuted, shunned. That's why Christ said, many will be called, but few will be chosen. This is our beliefs according to our book. People don't have to like it, agree with it, or understand it. This is our position. So before people make claims to know the Hebrew Israelite doctrine, it's best to hear from an Israelite to show you a few things. That's just a few minor things that we believe according to the book. So guys, I hope this has been helpful to clear up a lot of things about the Israelites or these so-called Black Hebrew Israelites, which is ridiculous because of all the Latinos and Native Americans that are here. Sit with one of us, learn from us before you judge us saying that we're teaching false doctrine, we're false prophets. And who knows, maybe you could in fact be an Israelite and we can show you how the Bible says you need to repent and to serve the Most High, so you may have an opportunity to be of the elect. With this, one love.